Hello, everybody. Thank you for bearing with us through that. I think we figured it out. Thank you, everyone, for taking your time out and coming to join us tonight. I am so honored to present to you Teresa Rayford, who, as you know, is the mayor. And we have Anjali, who is going to be DJing for us. So Teresa, as some of you may know, grew up here in Portland, and she has firsthand knowledge of the institutional injustices against Black, Brown, and poor people from her history. And then she moved away and came back when her nephew was tragically killed as a victim of gun violence. And that began her path in this world of activism. And so she was first very active in creating change in her immediate community. And then that led her to trying to create change within the greater community of Portland. And one of the things that I admire a lot about Teresa is that she is very steadfast in holding our leaders accountable. And so I'm really looking forward to the day where she becomes one of those leaders, because I'll know that that accountability and integrity will be in that position of power. And she is the only woman of color running for mayor. And I would love to introduce to you to another wonderful, amazing woman of color, DJ Anjali, who has been a staple in the Portland DJ scene for the past 20 years. I know when I moved here in 2004, you were already a major player in that scene and probably one of the only women of color, and maybe even still to this day, one of the only women of color.
There's more now, now than when I started, for sure. Yeah.
So I just feel so honored to be sharing the screen with the two of you, and just also how inspirational it is for maybe other young women of color to see both of you here and all the things that you're both doing within your communities.
Thanks for having me.
And thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Yes. So we're going to start the night with Anjali playing some wonderful music, Bollywood music, probably, I'm assuming. But would you like to introduce your music?
Sure. I do play Bollywood music, which is music specifically from the films that come out of Bombay or Mumbai, like the Hindi film industry. But I think today I'll probably play Bhangra, which is a Punjabi folk music that's, basically kind of morphed into like modern club music. And that's like probably the sound I'm most known for, though I do play, I play a lot of other sounds. Like I play kind of within the South Asian diaspora, there's like Asian underground, and there's kind of a more desi bass sound, which doesn't really fit into the Bollywood or the Bhangra kind of categories. But I also play like Balkan, like club music and Arabic dance music, and a lot of Spanish language music, like dembo and reggaeton and cumbia. I throw, when we're in pre-quarantine life, I throw club parties. So I also, I have two community radio shows. Well, there's the KBOO show that the kid does, and I used to do, and then there's the X-Ray show. So we kind of do the club DJing thing, but also we do the DJ radio thing. And, I DJ weddings, private parties, all kinds of things. And then I also teach dance. So I do teach Bollywood dance, and I teach Bhangra, the Punjabi folk dance. So I thought, because I'm a DJ, it's not so exciting to watch a DJ, I might do a little mini lesson within my set. Go ahead.
I just wanted to bring attention to something that you were talking about earlier, is about the importance of creating safe places for people of color, and with the music that you do, how that activism is inherent in the kind of music that you play, because of what it does for the community.
We attempt to have our spaces be safe spaces, and that's the ultimate goal, though of course it's, people drinking, so sometimes it's difficult to monitor those situations with hundreds of people. But inherently, like you just said, I play music that's not in English. So a lot of Urdu, Hindi, Punjabi, Tamil, and Spanish, and some Arabic, and maybe like Roma languages, like Bulgarian or something. So that in and of itself is like music made by brown and black and indigenous people around the world, and then being heard on club systems in the whitest like city in America. I don't think I could never play that music without having some kind of solidarity with the other communities of color, and like live with myself, you know what I mean? Like, yes, it's party music, but ultimately I feel like whether you're an immigrant that came here, you know, on an S-1B visa to work at Intel, or you're an immigrant that came here to provide and send money back home to your country, like, I think there's, within South Asian culture, there's so much casteism and colorism that in my own rebellious way, just I want my own people to see that actually we're all immigrants in this like white supremacist nation, and that we can be out in the streets and we can be protesting together, or you know, lobbying for our causes together, but also we can party together, right? And I just think there's so much beautiful energy on the dance floor when we can come together and experience each other's music. Because my DJ partner, The Incredible Kid, we throw two parties, and we do one party that's all like South Asian music, and we do another party called Tropithal that's Latin and South Asian. And we think the music, you know, blends so well together, but ultimately, like, I feel like there's just solidarity on the dance floor. And yeah, taking over nightclubs and having it be predominantly Black, Brown, and Indigenous humans, you know, I just, there's so much, I don't know, there's just so much special energy. And people who move here from other cities are like, wow, your parties remind me of home, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just think inherently that exists with the music for me. I don't know about other people, but yeah, solidarity on the dance floor is like a thing that is just really central to what I do.
Yeah, I love that.
Thanks.
Okay, without further ado.
Okay, sorry, I talked too much. I said I was going to be shy about talking and I talked too much. Okay, so just I'm going to switch over, and then I won't be able to hear you talk to you, right?
Yep,
okay.
You got it.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Of course. So I might do a little dance lesson, so be prepared to move, everybody.
Yeah. Kid. Yeah. I ride through the ghetto, windows down halfway.
Okay, should we do a little dance lesson? I can't see anybody, so let's just try this. We're gonna do our little shoulders up. Even if you're sitting in your chair, you can just move your shoulders up a little bit. All right, we're gonna go a little faster.
Jatta shariyam tu tatka kar de, jatta shariyam.
We're gonna do our arms up in a V shape, and then we're gonna pull in at the elbow. ਗੱਭਰੂਨਾ ਬੁੱਕੇ ਕਿਸੇ ਹੋਰ ਸਿਰ ਤੇ ਆਹ ਲੋਕ ਕੰਮ ਕਰਦੇ ਸਕੀਮਾਂ ਨਾਲ ਦੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਕੰਮ ਕੱਢਦੇ ਆ ਯੋਰ ਸਿਰ ਤੇ ਆਹ ਟਾਈਮ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਹ ਬੀਬਾ ਸਾਡਾ ਡੰਡਾ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਐਵੇਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਹ ਲੋਕ ਖਾਲੀ ਰਾਹ ਕਰਦੇ ਆਹ ਸਾਡਾ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ
ਸ਼ੇਰ ਕਰੇ ਚੇਂਜ ਬੱਲੀਏ ਡਿਵਾਈਡਰ ਤੂੰ ਛੱਡ ਆਈ ਅੜੀ ਉੱਤੇ ਨੀ ਆ ਹਿੱਕਾਂ ਉੱਤੇ ਚਾਰ ਦੀਏ ਰੇਂਜ ਬੱਲੀਏ ਔਕਾ ਤੇਜ ਤੇ ਕਲੇਸ਼ ਦੇ ਦੀ ਜਦੋਂ ਮਰਜੀ ਭੱਜ ਭੱਜ ਪੈਣੇ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਹ ਨਾ ਕਰਦੇ ਉਹ ਸਾਡਾ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ
ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਐਂਡ ਯੂ ਆਰ ਗੋਇੰ ਟੂ ਬ੍ਰਿੰਗ ਯੂਰ ਆਰਮ ਇਨ ਐਂਡ ਬੈਂਡ ਐਟ ਦ ਐਲਬੋ ਸੋ ਲਾਈਕ ਆਈ ਸੈਡ ਬਿਫੋਰ ਯੂਰ ਹੈਂਡਸ ਆਰ ਕਾਈਂਡ ਆਫ ਲੂਸ ਯੂ ਕੈਨ ਹੈਵ ਯੂਰ ਫਿੰਗਰਸ ਟੁਗੇਦਰ ਜਸਟ ਨਾਟ ਟੂ ਟਾਈਟ We're going to have arms straight in a 45 degree angle and then we're going to pull in looks like khwara tak ve charche hi rende tere bare chalde vairiya tu lake kalakara tak ve tiro ka vangu tatho sare chalde aive jatta lead karda mandir nu taas jo jo hukm da yakka karda jatta shariyam tu ta takka 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 karda
aao apne siran de utto aap baneya ਗੱਭਰੂ ਨਾ ਬੁੱਕੇ ਕਿਸੇ ਹੋਰ ਸਿਰ ਤੇ ਆਓ ਲੋਕ ਕੰਮ ਕਰਦੇ ਸਕੀਮਾਂ ਨਾਲ ਨੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਕੰਮ ਕੱਢਦੇ ਆ ਜੋੜ ਸਿਰ ਤੇ ਆਓ ਟਾਈਮ ਨਹੀਂ ਓ ਬੀਬਾ ਸਾਡਾ ਡੰਡਾ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਐਵੇਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਓ ਲੋਕ ਖਾਲੀ ਰਾਹ ਕਰਦੇ ਓ ਸਾਡਾ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ
Okay, so that first move when your arms are up in a V shape, you're pulling in, in. The second move when your hand is in this mudra, we're going to kind of place our arm. So there's a difference between the two. So let's practice both.
ਫਿਲਮ ਤਾਂ ਰੱਖੀ ਮਨ ਵਿੱਚ ਹੀ ਫਿਰਦਾ ਆਓ ਮੂਸੇ ਵਾਲਾ ਯੱਟ ਨਾਟ 11 ਵਰਗਾ ਕੱਲਾ ਹੀ ਇੰਡਸਟਰੀ ਨੂੰ ਖਿੱਚੀ ਫਿਰਦਾ ਆਓ ਆਉਂਦੇ ਸਾਲ ਸੁਰਤ ਨਹੀਂ ਲੈਣ ਦੇਣੀ ਨੀ ਹੋ ਗਾਣੇ ਦੇਖੀ ਆਉਂਦੇ ਠਾ ਠਾ ਕਰਦੇ ਹੋ ਸਾਡਾ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਚੱਲਦਾ ਏ ਧੱਕਾ
ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਕਰਦੇ ਆਓ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਕਿਸਮਤ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੈਣਾ ਲਿਖਿਆ ਦੱਸ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਕਿੰਜ ਦੁਨੀਆ ਠੱਲੂ ਉਹ ਕਿੰਨੇ ਹੀ ਲੀਕ ਕਰ ਲਿਓ ਕਿੰਨੇ ਹੀ ਵੀਕ ਕਰ ਲਿਓ ਓਏ ਮੂਸੇਆਲਾ ਪੁੱਤ ਇਹ ਤਾਂ ਓਨੇ ਹੀ ਜੱਲੂ
But you're going to clasp your two hands together. Okay, and then we're going to tap our hip, shoulder, hip, shoulder, other side, hip, shoulder, hip, shoulder. Have been kind of a combination of two different styles of Punjabi folk dance. You've got Bhangra, which is traditionally the men's dance, and then you've got Gidda, which is traditionally the ladies' dance. And I really like to switch up between the two back and forth. So I just want to show you a couple more little Gidda moves. Gidda is actually way faster than Bhangra, but you know, it's hard to dance to that all night. So I'm just going to show you a few moves. We're going to have our hands
clasp together right in front of our face like this, and then we're gonna clap away from our face. We're gonna kind of brush out. I'll walk you through it. So you're going to kind of clap away from your face, and then you're going to clap towards your face, and then meeting your palms together in the middle.
ਪੀਣ ਵਾਲੀ ਕਾਫੀ ਇੱਥੇ ਮਿਲਣੇ ਸਟੀਲ ਦੇ ਗਲਾਸ ਨੀ ਉਹ ਕੁੰਡੀਆਂ ਤੇ ਪਤਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਹ ਬੈਜ ਕਦੋਂ ਰੇਡ ਪੈਂਦਾ ਕਿਤੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਰੱਖਣਾ ਪਲਾਸ ਨੀ ਉਹ ਕੁੰਡੀਆਂ ਤੇ ਪਤਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਉਹ ਬੈਜ ਕਦੋਂ ਰੇਡ ਪੈਂਦਾ ਕਿਤੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਰੱਖਣਾ ਪਲਾਸ ਨੀ ਰਹਿਣ ਨਜ਼ਰਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਲੱਕ ਤੇ ਤੜਾਕੀਆਂ ਨੀ ਗਲ ਵਿੱਚ ਚੈਨ ਵਾਲੀਏ ਸਾਡੇ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਦੇ ਨੇ ਮੁੰਡੇ ਬੜੇ ਚੱਕਵੇਂ ਨੀ ਚੰਡੀਗੜ੍ਹ ਰਹਿਣ ਵਾਲੀਏ
ਕਚਹਿਰੀਆਂ ਦੀ ਕਿਹੜੀ ਹਰ ਦਿਨ ਦੀ ਸਟੋਰੀ ਤੇਰੀ ਹਰ ਇੱਕ ਫਰਮੈਸ ਤੇ ਕਰਾਉਂਦਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਐਸ਼ ਉਹਦੇ ਬਿਨ ਫਿਰ ਮੌਜਾ ਵੀ ਨੀ ਹੋਣੀ ਹੋਜੂ ਤੇਰਾ ਸਤਾਰਾ ਬੰਦ ਕਿਹੜੀ ਰੂਟ ਬੰਦ ਕੌਣ ਬੇਟਾ ਪਾਉ ਤੈਨੂੰ ਪੀਜੀ ਦੀ ਕੰਧ ਦੱਸ ਦੱਸ ਕਿਹੜਾ ਫਿਰ ਖਰਚੇ ਕਰੂਗਾ ਜੱਟ ਮੁੜ ਕੇ ਤੇ ਸੁਣਾ ਚੰਡੀਗੜ੍ਹ ਬਣ ਜੂਗਾ ਬੇਬੀ
ਉਹ ਚੱਲੂ ਕਿਵੇਂ ਦੂਜੀ ਤੇ ਸਨੈਪਚੈਟ ਤੇਰਾ ਜਦੋਂ ਕਰੇਂਗੀ ਸਰਚ ਬੈਸ ਬੈਸ ਨੀ ਖੇਤ ਗੱਟੇ ਦੀ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ ਤੇ ਮਾਰੇ ਆਡੀ ਉੱਤੇ ਕਿਹੜਾ ਖੁੱਲਾ ਕਰਦਾ ਖਰਚ ਬੈਸ ਬੈਸ ਨੀ ਖੇਤ ਗੱਟੇ ਦੀ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ ਤੇ ਮਾਰੇ ਆਡੀ ਉੱਤੇ ਕਿਹੜਾ ਖੁੱਲਾ ਕਰਦਾ ਖਰਚ ਬੈਸ ਬੈਸ ਨੀ ਉਹ 14-15 ਨੇ ਫੌਜੀ ਪਿੰਡੋਂ ਭਰਤੀ ਨੀ ਬੌਂਸਰਾ ਨਾ ਬਹਿਣ ਵਾਲੀਏ ਸਾਡੇ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਦੇ ਨੇ ਮੁੰਡੇ ਬੜੇ ਚੱਕਵੇਂ ਨੀ ਚੰਡੀਗੜ੍ਹ ਰਹਿਣ ਵਾਲੀਏ ਸਾਡੇ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਦੇ ਨੇ ਮੁੰਡੇ ਬੜੇ ਚੱਕਵੇਂ ਨੀ ਚੰਡੀਗੜ੍ਹ ਰਹਿਣ ਵਾਲੀਏ
I think this is going to be the last song, not a Punger song, but it is like an Indian electronic song that I just love. Maybe we can all just spaz out and do our own dance.
हर चीज खास है अब है जो है वो समा है तुम रह सके तो रबा है अब है जो है वो समा है तुम रह सके ऐसी जीत अब चाहे जिंदगी ऐसी जीत अब चाहे जिंदगी है सहनी हमें सजा है हम है बाजारों के सबकी नजर यहाँ है हर चीज राज है अब है जो है वो समा है तुम रह सके तो रबा है अब है जो है वो समा है तुम रह सके ऐसी जीत अब चाहे जिंदगी ऐसी जीत अब चाहे जिंदगी है ਛੁਪ ਛੁਪਾਏ ਐਸੀ ਜੀ हम न पाए ऐसी जिंदगी हम छिप छिपाए हम न आए 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 हम न आए ऐसी जी छिप छिपाए ऐसी जी हम न पाए
Hey. All right, thanks for letting me do my little thing there. I'm gonna switch back. So it's not just me coming out of the sound system here.
Yay.
Yay.
There we go. Hopefully that is.
I have to sit back down.
I know, that was amazing. I didn't think I was going to be sweating.
Okay, good.
Wow, some of that was hard.
Thank you. It's one of those things. It looks easy and then it is kind of hard.
No.
Yeah. I think we tend to, in like America, we tend to dance like this, arms go out, and like in Bhangra, you pull in. So it's like a little bit of an opposite direction.
I was like, this is a workout. This is good. I'm so proud and thankful.
Thank you for having me.
No, I'm sweating out my eyebrows. It's
so great. Okay, well, I want all of our viewers and listeners to know that there is a chat box that I would love to have people's questions for Teresa. And also below is the lineup for the rest of the series, which should be for another, which is for another week till the 15th. Do you guys have anything you want to say before I go to questions?
Well, one of the things that our campaign has been doing for the last 18 months, and really I guess since last summer, is just asking people through a survey what matters to them. So I wanted to ask DJ Angele, what matters to you? Because you just shared your culture and your art. And we were talking about your family's history ahead of time. So I know a little bit about you, but what in this world, like you're connected to politics, community. What do you see happening in Portland? What matters to you? What do you think we need to?
I think there's a couple kind of big things for me. One is Portland being a sanctuary city. Abolishing ICE here, I don't know, abolishing ICE in general and not having kids in cages at borders and in detention centers. That's big. The Green New Deal, not expanding I-5, not expanding, and improving our air quality here. Our air quality is horrible. I live in deep southeast right near Precision Cast Parts, and I feel like the glass factory thing that happened a few years ago, that got so much news. And that's horrible. Arsenic in our soil and in our air is horrible for all of us. But then I feel like, Berkshire Hathaway owns Precision Cast Parts, which is right down here in Johnson Creek. And I think a lot of Portlanders don't know that a few years ago it was voted the dirtiest factory in America. And it's right here in our backyard where, Portland is surrounded by all these freeways. And if you live near a freeway, your air quality is horrible. We don't have, the diesel emissions that Washington and California do. We're stuck here in the middle with ancient, diesels running on the highways. And, asthma affects children of color and people of color more. Like, we don't live in lofty, if hilltop homesteads, so that's the thing that's really important to me. The Green New Deal and immigrant rights, those are kind of like huge for me. And then the other thing, just as an old Portlander and like a lifelong, I've lived in other places, but I've mostly lived in Oregon my whole life. Just the kind of the chipping away at the character of our city, and it's become such a playground for the rich in a way, not to diss on Californians, but people having second homes here who work in the tech industry, and you know, old historical Black neighborhoods like being demolished, gentrification, so that Airbnb can come in here. And our city, basically our mayor, our last two mayors, I feel like, or three or four, honestly, have basically upheld this kind of like, hey, developers, come on in, our city's for sale for you. Let's change the waterfront. Oh, that was a super fun site. Like, oh, well, let's put up like high rise condos. And oh, I'm sorry, you live in East Portland, you don't have sidewalks in front of your grade schools, and your city streets are basically potholes and just gravel. And you know, so those are kind of my big three things.
But I'm just saying, and I appreciate you telling me that, because with your platform, like, I'm a community organizer. I had to start a nonprofit so that I could continue to seek justice and be credible and just respecting like my space and how we use bureaucracy, and it was still resistance. And then we talked earlier about archivism and, you know, historical documents. A lot of the things that we're talking about right now, like the Superfund, Waterfront Park, Commissioner Jordan was the first Black, you know, parks commissioner. And not only was Portland, you know, the, what do we call it, Pioneer Square, not only did he build that space so that we could have open spaces for community to gather, but he also did the renovation of Waterfront Park. He also invested in all of the park systems, and that's where I grew up at. Like, they had real programming and community engaged programming that was supporting those neighborhoods that no longer have access, that we have access to. But the thing is that I grew up over there. I grew up with lead in our schools, lead in our homes. I grew up having asthma. I still have asthma. I know when it's a bad air day. I don't have to turn on the news to know it. I can't breathe. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And I see that there is a lack of investment, but we always hear these promises. And usually around the time when we're running for office, you know, when it's time for a political season to happen, you hear all these very innovative promises about what we're going to do in regards to equity. Oh, we're going to build 20-minute neighborhoods. We're going to have sidewalks. We're going to invest money into, you know, redevelopment and rehabilitation instead of demolitions, so that we can provide, like, I literally went to the state capitol with people rallying around, you know, aspects of what we could do as community members to influence legislation and policy to, like, kind of, you know, cash in on some of those promises, like for some of the inequities you just said. And without us having our own political power and the education around how a process works, we're not gonna get leaders to do what we need them to do. And so I'm just hoping that, like, we're in 2020 right now, right? We've seen what Donald Trump can do. We've seen the America that allowed him to become elected after we made so many strides in building equality for all of us. And so what I would be mindful is that that happened while Donald Trump, while President Obama was our president. And at that time, we did know that there were videos out there. We did know that there was police brutality. We did know that there was overrepresentation of, you know, communities of color, not only being forced into the criminal justice system, but being investigated and being turned over to ICE just as a retaliation through community policing efforts. And so none of us have even ever felt safe enough to really call the police. If you're a, you know, an immigrant woman and you're dealing with domestic violence, it's not likely that you're gonna call anybody for help. And then the people in your community, we have to learn how to take care of each other to deal with that and to handle our business. But the way that society is here, we don't get the opportunity to be progressive in the way that we serve our families. Everything is about policing. Everything is about targeting. Everything is about investigation and displacement. And so we have to change that, but we have to have the courage to get people to lead us in the city. Like a mayor, look at how goofy Ted is. And I don't like to talk about people. There's so much I could say about this election right now that's happening that I can't believe, and it's hard to stomach that it's actually happening in real time with all the struggles that we've done. And it's like, oh, come on, when is the insult gonna be over? It's gonna be over when we obtain political power. That's when the investment in our communities will happen. I just got off a call with all the construction companies that are coming together that are from all the minority communities. And really, they just wanted to know, are you gonna pay us for our fair work? Are we going to be overworked? Are you going to enforce partnerships that are supposed to return us, you know, deliver on a return on investment? Are we going to have fair contracting and opportunities? And I hang out with the auditors. Mm-hmm. I help get people access to legal support. It's not going to happen. There's nothing in any of the planning and decision making for any of our communities of color, for any women in this city, to even protect us against sexual violence or any of those things that we're known for in this city. And we have to make those protections available to us. We can't just say, well, let's let the process work itself out. We have to be bold and courageous, and we have to make change possible. And right now it is possible.
I think one more thing I wanted to add is that I feel like Ted Wheeler, you know, ran 4 years ago on one of his things in his platform was the homeless crisis here in Portland. And has it changed? I feel like it's gotten worse. That's such like a dire scenario. People living on the streets in before quarantine and now with COVID, it's a horrible situation. And that's, I know people are working on it, but I feel like it's like, you know, every time I read in the paper, it's like, well, we're going to spend another 40 grand on a study. You know, it's like, well, just people need housing. That's the study. You know, it's like a dire need. So that's just the last thing I wanted to add.
Oh, I'm glad you added that, because the thing is that what we keep hearing from our leaders is that I'm going to look into that, or we're going to get a person that's going to be the one that's in charge of doing all of this work. And what they say it as if it's so easy to be put in the position that we're in. Like, we didn't fall in these positions of inequity. The systems around us influenced the opportunity for policy to mandate it. And so that has to be what happens. You can't hire one person to go into that community and bridge all those efforts on behalf of the city. And I watched those things happen when they build up committees. So, I mean, everything that you said, the function of that change is gonna start with the ballot. And we know that, you know, it's going to start with the ballot. It's going to start with getting those leaders in there. And it's going to start with building out what that leadership, what it really means for our generation to say that we're decolonizing this city. And we want to make a standard of not, you know, allowing ICE into our communities, mm-hmm. not waiving people's rights to privacy for them to receive services, not policing the efforts of poverty, not allowing people to make money here like the legal recreational cannabis community that is dying to put their money into housing our unhoused community, you know, like, and no one's listening to them. I go to them and they're like, still out of all the events we've done together in partnership over the whole year, no elected officials, except for like, you know, people we don't want to talk about, are connecting with them and thinking about how to change that revenue into a source of change and an investment. And I'm sorry, I'm long-winded like you.
No, it's okay. I just feel like, I just feel like the city government maybe hasn't, you know, they haven't held the business community accountable for like, oh, we're going to help you, you know, you can build this building of new condos and a certain percentage needs to be for low-income folks. And then, oh, whoops, we forgot to kind of include that. And then they're not held accountable. And it's the same, it's the same with the air quality. Like, these businesses can just spew out whatever they want into our air anyway.
It's intentional. Everything on the record shows you the reasonableness of why we would do it and what the outcome is going to be. And the reason that those things are happening in poor communities is the intentionality of getting away with it. Mm-hmm. We know it's inhumane. We know it harms. I didn't know people lived past 50 years old. When I was a kid, that was old. Wow. But it was because they were dying early because of the environment and where we lived and how we were fed and how things, you know, just trying to get a job, you know, walking to the store every day, the emotional trauma of the racism in our society. And then we're competing for jobs as well. Like, we need someone to build a unity. And a real unity, not something they have to get trained on equity for or to unlearn their bias to get to. To me, it's an honor to be introduced to new cultures, and it's an honor to respect and to affirm them. I don't have to own them, and we are not for entertainment purposes. You know what I'm saying? But this city has that standard when it comes to our lives. And we know that, we feel it, and we continue to tolerate it. We don't have to do that anymore. That's what all of this is about in the world that we're dealing with. We're on so much of another level at this point to where we know that the vote is in our hand and that we can make change. But what I've researched and what I've learned is that we keep trusting them because we've been trained and taught to trust it. It looks right. Oh, he looks like a leader. Oh, he's saying all those right things. Anybody will say whatever they need to say to get to the bottom line. And when you just want to serve somebody, check this out. If I said that, oh, okay, elect me and I don't need a salary, he wouldn't say that. You know, Sarah wouldn't say that. Sarah needs the money. You know, Ozzy probably doesn't need it, but nobody's going to say, let me do the work for free. I've literally done it for free for 10 years. I researched exactly everything about this city that needed to make it better. And the fact that they were only missing the people, the fact that your biggest bridge to opportunity was the lack of engagement, that you would not do, that you do not want to communicate with people, that you will not invest in the communication with people because you want to own the answers so that you can quantify things that don't benefit them. Mm. To me, that's racketeering. Come on. I'm like, I'm always wanting the Department of Justice to step in, but we got Donald Trump. So who do you get to help you? Mm-hmm. You have to have people you know.
Thank you for making noise and for being loud and yeah, for doing all the work.
We do it together. It's a community action plan. Everybody knows their part and we work together to figure it out, but we're getting where we need to go. This is a very great opportunity for me to be one of four contenders and to be homegrown in our community. And one of the biggest things that has impacted our campaign is the fact that I never took the bribe. You know, every time somebody was like, well, you know, you probably don't want to be the mayor right now and you want this good job over here. No, I'm going to do this. Well, what if it doesn't work? People will be inspired. They'll be activated. They'll be motivated. But guess what? It's working. We started early because we knew it was going to be hard for us. And we've been knocking on doors. And the fact that you're here today, the fact that Anna has built up this big space for us, community members that were not getting to hear from me because, of course, I was being blacked out in the media or they would keep it on my organization's work and not propose that maybe this public servant that won the best category for two different reasons was someone that was competent enough to serve us as a public servant agent. And I'm thankful that you're here helping me get this done because we will win. We will win. We only have 2 weeks left. And I'm excited because I'm thinking about the inauguration. I'm like, the inauguration is going to be bonkers.
So, Teresa, you kind of addressed this, but we do have a question from the chat that I would like yes. to ask you. The Incredible Kid asks, what are the most important moves we need to be making to protect vulnerable communities in Portland during this crisis, especially in the face of so much government inactivity and foot dragging?
And that's the problem. We need to build in more mutual aid. When I used to do organizational protesting and organizing, we could get 10,000 people to show up in the streets. We could get people to show up in neighborhoods when Ted became mayor and people were literally dying in their neighborhoods. We were able to fast track those resources to people just through our dynamics of community outreach. And so I was on a call last night because there are people in my community being murdered right now by vigilantes that think that, you know, you shouldn't be running around without a mask or you shouldn't be running or just existing right now. So we're dealing with that. And one of the dynamics of dealing with it in a COVID-19 world is that you can't really get and strategize and organize with people in your community. But the fact that we know that there's all these different dynamics of change that need to happen and need to be continuous, even though we're traumatized, pick one. If it's hunger relief, if it's helping our disabled community and showing up to go and buy prescriptions and drop them off, if it's helping walk dogs for people that can't go outside anymore, whatever you can do in your immediate space, be there for your community because people are just now checking in on their phones. People now like taking phone calls again. And we got to a point where we wouldn't answer phones, but now we like to hear each other's voice. So check in on people. Anything you can do to just connect yourself to other humans, just to show concern so that we feel that back because we're being inundated with so much trauma right now, not only the stuff that's happening in Washington, D.C., and trying to figure out if you're gonna be able to pay your rent or if the stimulus is gonna come or if the city shut down or all that, but just at home every single day in that space. you know, we are people that are supposed to be able to be out in our parks and do what we need to do. But as people of color, we know that we're being targeted. We know that people are looking at us differently because we're outside. And I'm mindful that there's people outside all around me, but I'm still looked at, or it's starting to happen again. It seemed like it stopped for a little while, but it is starting to happen again. And just be mindful that it is. And if you need to step up for other people that might have anxiety about just going to the store, just, you know, check in on your people. That's the most important thing you can do right now. I can't even believe we're running a campaign right now during this pandemic. But if we dig back into our emotions and our humanity, use that right now as a level of opportunity and let somebody know that you're there for them.
Oh, that's a really good point. Yeah, thank you. It's
very important right now.
Mm-hmm. Very good reminder. Okay, so we're coming to the end of our show, and we do have one other question that came in. I'm going to read it out. This came from a woman through social media. I recently had to uproot my life and move back home to take care of my father, who has dementia. It's difficult to get consistent resources for him, and it's hard to be his main caretaker with no direct services. It's a lot of referrals and waiting. What do you think could be done differently for resources to have more direct access to those services?
Exactly. One of the things here that I've been working on and that I saw an inefficiency was that our housing programs already had identified people that were mostly marginalized, or what we say disadvantaged and at risk. But there was no real factor in communicating resources and services to those same community members. So you would get someone that would, you know, literally be in housing, but they would have a housing situation like a sick parent. And the access to services and how to get access and navigate those systems wasn't always readily available. And even our social workers are overburdened. The biggest issue about all that was that here in the state of Oregon, and I don't know where the caller is from, but in the state of Oregon, we had to lobby so that home health care providers could get the same type of resources that the nurses and the care providers that were coming to their homes was getting. And that was a little bit of leverage that gave access to, if your family is on subsidized housing, now you can legally be on the lease. If your family member has a critical disease or a fatal disease like cancer or something, dementia or Alzheimer's, now you can actually get a stipend for providing care, and then you still are not interfering with the resources for someone else to come in and provide access, additional care. And through that type of service, we're able to provide access to the additional resources that you would need. And that's something that the city and the health department, when they're working together, bridging those efforts, which we haven't fully done here. We got the resources for the families, but now it's time to communicate that those distributable resources exist. And I don't think that people have to worry about, I hate when they have to worry about, where is it? Why do I have to have a website to find it? What if I don't have the internet? I think that the fact that they're already in the system, they should be the first people to receive that information, and in whatever way we feel that it needs to be done. There was an issue that we had a couple of years ago with a collective bargaining agreement. And one of the things that we testified to, because of the data, it showed that there was an overrepresentation of stops. Well, one of the things I suggested was that when those stops are made, why aren't we texting that person that was stopped and grading and doing a survey on those services, so that we can not only identify if there was a reason or a not, an unnecessary reason for the stop, but also so that we could find out if there were additional services that that person might need. Because I had a conversation with the association president, and he said, well, when people are being stopped for their lights, and I was like, well, what if at the end of that call, you put that in there and you gave them a referral? Because they were telling me, yeah, and the majority of them aren't fixing them because they don't have a job and this and that. And I'm like, well, you're overburdened with that. Those are things usual and customary that we know are happening. And when people are seeking support, we need to start wrapping those services up. We're still functioning on a system that's outdated, over 100 years old, and we still call it constitutional. It's inhumane. It was developed to be a practice of inhumane efforts so that we would create a lower class society that would take care of the people that were at the 1%. We know this. We know it. Caller, we know it. Find out who's lobbying in your state. Find out if there are state dollars that are available to families that are taking care of their loved ones, and dive into that. If there's somebody, if there aren't any, contact the senators and the representatives in your community and let them know that they need to go ahead and get something like that. And I'm sure there's organizations like Jobs with Justice that can help you out with that.
Wow, I love what you just said, which was, or the example that you just gave about if a police officer were to stop someone, instead of just reprimanding them for whatever, to offer them the service that they need.
Yeah, the point of contact, especially like in housing, from the time she got there, the health facility could have said, here's some examples of opportunities for you, like dig into this. We need to be more concerned with outcomes for people rather than the referral process. The referral process is quantifying data, outcomes, thinking of outcomes when we're connecting with people, when we provide those city services and those social services, that gives them a complete opportunity to be supported. Yes. Nobody taking care of their parents should be going back to the social office, you know, all the time to get support. That needs to be identified at the point of contact. And that's what I'm talking about with moving Portland forward. I want to develop the infrastructure that gets us an efficient outcome for the people that live here.
Yes, I love that. Well, thank you so much, Teresa.
Thank you.
Okay, any last closing words?
Well, I was talking to my mom, I don't know, a couple of months ago, and you know, we have many Bernie signs in our yard. And I think maybe, I don't know if Bernie had just stepped down or what, and maybe my stepdad said, oh, are you gonna take the signs down? And we said, of course not, we're still gonna vote for him in the primary. And my mom said something along the lines of, you know, when I was a single mom and you and your sister were young, I couldn't really be bothered to pay attention to politics. I was just trying to, you know, pay our bills. And I was like, Mom, that's what they want. That's what they want poor working people to think, is that we have no say, we have no connection. And beyond the ballot box, like beyond voting for, you know, people that actually care about the working poor, the working class, is that we can also get ourselves be involved. So that's kind of the thing I wanted to say, is I just think it's a tragedy, you know, and I think so often in Black and brown immigrant communities, I think, yeah, there's a fear of being deported, there's a fear of ICE, there's a fear of the police. And so I think a lot of immigrants just kind of are like, well, I'm gonna step away and just kind of keep my head down and maintain the white supremacist kind of status quo in this country, because I don't want anybody to pay attention to me. I don't want to be thrown out or thrown in jail. It's like, it starts at the ballot box, and then of course we can go deeper in and become more personally involved. But I when I turned 18, I was so excited to vote. And I know it's kind of strange, like, I think most young people don't care about voting. And I guess, I hope that's changing. I think it's changing a little bit, but especially with the environment crisis that we're in. But it starts at the ballot box. So hopefully that's the like least people can do, right?
Yes. And I wanted to say, I just want to respond to what you said about that, because right now there are literally, I mean, when I was there when Ted proclaimed that we were a sanctuary city, and I had already read the language and it literally was not there. The fact that he was like, here's a big ton of money and we're gonna put the money over here to a group. There were no directives attached to it. There was no leadership. He expected, again, the burden of labor to be on our communities. Mm-hmm. And I was like, this is so disingenuous, because you have this Harvard education, you're the mayor, you have the city's resources at hand. Stand up. Like, tell them you are not about to allow anyone to be deported in this city. Tell them it is outlawed. Tell them that they cannot have contracts here. You know, tell them that they can't be in the schools and that they are not, I mean, like, make it illegal. Work with your auditors and let's go ahead and get that language together. And then let's hold the other commissioners accountable to being very strict in the language and the mandates. I mean, Keisha Bottoms was doing the stuff in Atlanta, like, no, we're not having bail, we're not, you know, like, let's get rid of the things that harm people. because that's literally what it takes, is the political will of that leader. I've gone in there as an activist and sat with auditors and then gone back in and testified with information that I learned on the record. And then guess what happens? Policy changes. Somebody comes up with a great idea and all of a sudden now we have something better that they came up with, but it's literally how powerful we are in this community and how they do work for us. But those paradigms have shifted. Like 2021, I don't even like to talk about it, but it's going to be done. We will lead our communities to where we need to go. We don't need to ask permission. You don't need to go through training to work with us or for us, because guess what? We can deliver. And when those resources are redistributed to communities that are actually engaged to the level where they're being invested in so they can engage, things will change radically. They say radically because it's built on white supremacy. When you smash it, that's what happens. It gets radical. We just need the power. There's so many people that have well intentions, but the leadership that we have right now, I don't care how well your intentions are, your experience has to help guide you.
Agreed.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Teresa. It's like such an honor to hang out with you.
Really, I'm happy. I'm thankful. I'm energized.
I want to remind everyone to drop their ballots off by May 19th or put them in the mail by May 14th. Get those ballots in for Teresa. And we'll end with another song by DJ Anjali.
Yeah. Okay. Give me one second. Thank you for bringing us together, Anna.
You're welcome. Thank you, Anna. Thank you, Anjali. I love it. Thank you.
Of course. Okay, I'll put a little song on, and when I do, I guess I'll have to mute you. So I'll say goodbye. Thank you. Have a good night. Let's see. How's this going to work? We're going to get a little clubby.
Flush your light as high if you feel it. Flush your light as high if you feel it. Deep, deep. if you feel it. Push your hands up high if you feel it. DJ KJ, pull it, pull it. Push your hands up high if you feel it. If you know that you're show wild out. Flash your lighters high if you feel it. Hands in the air, show, show wild out. Push your hands up high if you feel it. If you know that you're show wild out. Flash your lighters high if you feel it. No bad vibes inside. Drop that big dot, you're sinking bad gal, bad gal. Big dot, you're sinking bass. Drop that big dot, you're sinking bad gal, bad gal. Big dot, you're sinking bass. Drop that big dot, you're sinking bad gal, bad gal. Big dot, you're sinking bass. Drop that big dot, you're sinking bad gal, bad gal. Bass in the city, hype in the place. Push your hands up high if you feel it. If you know that you're show wild out. Flash your lighters high if you feel it. Hands in the air, show, show wild out. Push your hands up high if you feel it. If you know that you're show wild out. Flash your lighters high if you feel it. DJ, DJ, pull it. No hiding, that, that, pull it, pull it.
Yay. Maybe they already left. I think it ended, yes?